And now it's time for Healthy University, the program dedicated to the issues that affect the health of you and your family. Brought to you by Scotland County Hospital in Memphis, Missouri. Here's your host of the show, Dr. Randy Tobler.
Good morning, and thank you, Diamond Dave. That was Diamond Dave, wasn't it?
We got a new
announcer.
Yes, yes.
All right. Well, thank you for that. Wow. Maybe, does he want a free membership to the fitness club for that or something? I don't know.
Did a great job.
Yeah, he didn't send us a bill for that. That was awesome.
He is a professional broadcaster to the nth degree.
So it's good to be with you. Happy New Year from me, because I was delivering the first baby of the new year along with Dr. Davis last week, and we are going to celebrate that. Is that in this week's paper?
I believe, yes.
Woohoo! Good. Mm. Well, that'll be fun.
Always a box of chocolates if you're going to show up or not.
Oh, come on.
It really is.
It's a box of chocolates. Oh, honey, guess what? I'm not going to be there. Okay.
Yeah, that's okay.
All righty.
And what's Elisa's blood pressure? What's a bad blood pressure?
Oh, come on. You guys are radio professionals at this point. I don't know. I've been told when I show up, it's like the yucky raspberry-centered chocolates.
No.
You know, I got a couple boxes of chocolates from various folks for the holiday. And when you share them, it's an interesting study in human psychology. When you share the chocolate box with people,
yeah.
It's sort of like when you share the mixed nuts with people. You know, do you notice these things over the holidays?
Who takes what?
I love to observe behavior.
Please, elaborate.
It's funny. It's like, well, everyone's favorite is what? All together now. The caramels.
No.
Yes.
Chocolate with the nuts.
Oh, yeah. No, for you, it's the nuts. But for most people, it's those square ones.
No.
So if I was going to manufacture the box, instead of Russell Stover, it would be Randy Tobler. Chocolates.
Oh, got
it. And I would put... You know, the flowery one that looks like a little leaf and has the etched, you know, veins of the leaf in it? That would be the caramel. And and the square one would be the one with, like, the yucky, orange, squishy, stuffy yucky that no one wants. They're always the ones that are still there in June.
Yeah.
So what do you think of that for a marketing idea, Elisa?
You bet.
Instead of Russell Stover, we're going to do Randy Tobler chocolates.
Oh, okay.
And I'm going to put the caramels in the chocolate, the shape that looks like a leaf with the little etched veins in it, or the little circular one. And you think it's going to be the yucky raspberry or mango orange or yuck. And the caramels would be in the other ones. What do you think? It'd be sort of a reverse psychology thing. So all those people that reach for the square ones would get yucky peppermint or whatever.
I have a question.
What?
Yes.
But what are we going to do with those triangle pieces that are already named after you, the Toblerones?
Oh, the Toblerones. Well, I don't know. We'd have to stuff those with a little caramel.
We already have. Yeah, and they do. They do have the Toblerones.
Understand. We are not related. We wish.
But do they have salt? Do they have salt on them?
No, not the salted
something
caramel.
About the little salted caramels.
Yes.
I don't know.
Or you could do it like our kids did and just stick your finger in the middle of each one. Yeah.
All right. Well, we're going to step aside, take a break, and then right away get to our very special guest this morning, because it is your lucky day, because the author of The Lucky Years
is on with us.
Yes. Dr. David Agus is on HealthyU this morning to talk about what it takes to thrive in the brave new world of health. And it is a brave new world of health with all of the technology. Interesting bio on Dr. Agus. He's an engineer dude, as well as an MD. So that's going to bring an interesting tech talk to the air, and we'll talk with him.
Interesting dynamics.
Yeah, we can't wait. Hey, if you want to call and ask him a question, please join in the conversation. 660-465-7225.
Or 1-800-748-7875.
Right back after this. Don't touch the dial, because you're going to learn a lot about health and technology and how they blend for the rest of your life.
Yes.
Stay tuned on HealthyU. Welcome back to HealthyU. It's 18 after the hour, and joining us now, Dr. David Agus, who is author of the New York Times bestsellers End of Illness and A Short Guide to a Long Life, and the new book, The Lucky Years. I can't wait to talk with Dr. Agus about how to thrive in the brave new world of health, because he's a professor of engineering and medicine in Southern California. How you doing, David? Thanks for joining us.
Oh, it's my privilege. I am doing great. Cold in New York City.
Cold here, too. We're looking at 10 and 12 and 15. How about you?
I'm a boy from L.A., so
being
in New York, I can't feel my ears.
And you see Dr. Agus on CBS as well. He's a contributor there, and one of the world's leading physicians and biomedical researcher. So it is a brave new world. Technology is taking over our lives. I know as physicians, we are engulfed with technology, certainly just in the day-to-day care of patients. I'm thinking EMR here. But there's much more focused, targeted, and probably patient beneficent technology that we'd like to talk about today. What does the brave new world mean to a biomedical engineer like you?
You know, it's like Andy Grove, we call it inflection point, the curve of progress versus time. And it literally is changing at a staggering pace where every week we have a new breakthrough. Mm-hmm. So this is the era of technology applied to health. This is the era of collecting your own data. This is the era of big data. And it's the time when it's convergence of technology and the ability to translate that to benefits of patients have all come together at once. So it's pretty exciting from all perspectives.
But it can also be scary for those who are looking at this world. To me, I mean, the analogy is going to the big box electronics store or the online, electronics store and looking at, 5 million options for, take your device. I mean, is it a phone? Is it a thumb drive? Is it a chip? Is it a camera? I think a lot of folks are just mystified by all of the options. I mean, we know about the apps. We know about the big sales of Fitbits and things like those, fitness trackers. But you're talking about a level deeper. I mean, a very personal, intimate level involving folks with technology, right, and their doctor.
Well, yeah, I think, what you're alluding to is a lot of noise in health.
Yeah.
And so when you go on the internet, you can find everything, mm-hmm. and it can be somewhat overwhelming, and that's why you need a filter. You know, the reason I do CBS and write books is to try to be that filter, and we need that. In order to get, behavior change, you need leadership, and it's sorely lacking in our space. So we all need to step up in that regard, but at the same time, it shifts the power, from the doctor to the consumer, and I love that. Medicine is going to change from the ground up, not the top down, and that's what we're starting to see.
So you talk in the book about editing your DNA. Let's just start there. I mean, we've talked, and our listeners have at least a conversational knowledge of epigenetics and, bookmarks on our DNA and sort of turning on and off genes. Is that what you're talking about or something deeper?
So this is something, there's an enzyme called CRISPR, C-R-I-S-P-R. Mm. That Science magazine called the Molecule of the Year last year. And it gives us the ability as scientists to change one letter in the 3 billion letters of DNA. And so it really is transformative. In China, earlier this year, they actually changed the DNA of an embryo. Scientists have changed the DNA of a mosquito, for example, so that it's resistant to malaria and can't spread it. And this is and will be transformative, ranging from correcting DNA errors in newborns all the way to maybe changing T cells so they can start to attack cancer or other diseases. So important, big, but certainly we need to bring in ethics and make sure it's done right mm-hmm. and not taken advantage of.
So these are really sci-fi level things. I mean, these are things that 20 years ago would have been on the on the Twilight Zone episodes. But
they're here today.
Yeah, and you're talking about therapeutics, essentially. What about preventive medicine for those who don't really have a problem yet and want to avoid it? I guess first we ought to learn about our risks, and you talk about that in the book in terms of targeting. One interesting part was about learning our virome, finding what viruses we've been exposed to in our life. And I guess that translates to then certain flags for the doctor to look at, right?
It's amazing is that we were very reductionist in how we looked at biology in our space. All of a sudden, if you've been exposed to a virus at a certain stage in development or a certain age or a combination, that may raise your risk for other things. If you had the flu, let's say you skipped the flu shot this year and got the flu, then, hopefully you'd survive. On a good year, 5,000 people die. On a bad year, 50,000. But if you survive, which you likely would, then your risk of heart disease and cancer are up a decade from now. And so the virome is a very inexpensive $25 chip that can say what you've been exposed to in your lifetime. And it'll be part of your record.
Wow.
Just like you wear that Apple Watch or the Fitbit, and you'll go in and you'll have your movement as part of your record. And so all of those will be a new dimension to us, and so will our microbiome. You have tenfold more bacteria in your body than human cells, and these control your metabolism, many things about you. All of this is new dimensions that are going to be part of our record going forward and give us much more information.
I really enjoy what you say about before you walk into the doctor's office, you're going to have a microchip you're going to hand the doctor, you know, before you're going to do the work before and the doctor's going to look at it. That's amazing.
Well, you could do something that we've dreamed of in medicine, right, which is actually having a conversation with the doctor. So instead of the doctor's office being the place to collect data, it's going to be the place to interpret data. And I think that's a tremendous transition where we can actually sit face-to-face instead of going and they draw your blood and check everything and call you 4 or 5 days over the phone with the result. Mm. You're going to go in with all your data and have a real conversation.
So what does that mean, though? I mean, does the doc? It's sort of like when you go to certain auto dealers, or whatever, but you buy a late model car and you can't go to your regular mechanic anymore. You have to go to the right dealer with the right plug, with the right computer to decipher the code on the car.
I mean, I think it's the old days. You would have to go to 5 different dealers to find out about the car.
Yeah.
Now you get one magazine and you see all of them.
Yeah.
And you actually go in and say, listen, I want to buy this Ford. Why is it better than the Chrysler this or than the Cadillac this? I think that's the era we're going to go to, is that what it's going to do, this technology, is actually make medicine more even-keeled, and so that, you know, it's going to bring up the lower doctors and make everybody equal. So it's going to be one of the great equalizers.
Mm-hmm.
So whether you're rich or poor or live in a big city or in the suburbs, you're going to get the same care because of these technologies.
What can you do once you have a problem? Let's say that you're, you know, 50-something and you have a collection of diagnoses. Is there hope that, you know, maybe you had that flu 20 years ago and you've passed that risk stage, you know, for that 10-year-out heart attack or whatever, but you've already got a little narrowing of the arteries, you've already been struggling with maybe pre-diabetes and on and on and on. How does technology then get involved at that point?
Oh, it's amazing. I mean, ranging disease by disease, you know, in cancer, all of a sudden now we can use the immune system to attack the cancer. So the Jimmy Carter-like therapies, you know, he's in his 90s, has melanoma in the brain, which just several years ago was a sure death sentence. Now it's a life sentence because every cancer has a don't eat me signal on its surface, and we can now block that with new drugs that are on the market. We can sequence your DNA if you have cancer and, you know, target the on switches with therapies. All of which are exciting. Diabetes, we just learned in the last couple months, one of the great risks for diabetes is artificial sweeteners. Mm. You know, when they came out, we thought they were the greatest food in the world. They hit our sweet tooth, yet they weren't absorbed, so no calories. So this recent study took 20-year-olds, and they gave them all of the approved artificial sweeteners. And after 2 weeks, they all had markers of prediabetes in their blood. They said, hey, that's interesting. Then they gave them antibiotics first, followed by the artificial sweeteners. No diabetes markers. So what the artificial sweeteners did is they changed the bacteria in the GI tract to change metabolism, push people toward diabetes. And there were 2 large studies trying to look at artificial sweeteners for weight loss, and they didn't work. At the end of the papers, the scientists blamed the people who were fat, saying, hey, sneak food on the side, that's why it didn't work. No, the science was wrong. Pretty wild.
That's interesting because we talked to someone, less than a year ago that said it had to do with sort of mixed signaling, that the body thought it was getting sweet and sugar and calories and it didn't, and therefore you overcompensated, and it sort of was a neuroendocrine mechanism that was proposed.
Yeah, all of a sudden we've learned, a whole new dimension. We never sequenced the human microbiome. You have tenfold more bacteria in your body than you do human cells in the body. There's tenfold more bacterial DNA in you than human DNA. And it's an important component to us. And just this year, the Human Microbiome Project started to identify the species, and it's a whole new area that we're focused on.
Dr. Agus, it's always very interesting to find out, how did you get into this? This is a very intricate, wonderful area you're in, but how did this start that you got into this area?
Well, I, like many doctors, I see 2 or 3 patients a week, and I have to look them in the eye and say, I have no more drugs to treat your disease.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And so it really is out of weakness and my neuroses that I have to push harder. I have a lab of 100 people that tries to develop new treatments and new technologies. And, you know, I'm trained as an engineer. And so I think, you know, a little bit differently than a biologist thinking.
Okay.
You know, a biologist wants to understand how everything works. The engineer says complex systems are sometimes really impossible to understand, but let's figure out a way to control it.
Mm.
So it's a very different way. You know, the climate modeler doesn't go up every day to 20,000 feet and measure the wind speed and the temperature. They look at the shape of the clouds, and it tells them everything.
Mm.
So I think doctors going forward have to be more like climate modelers than biologists.
What can a person do here in the heartland in rural Missouri? I mean, that's our audience. Mm-hmm. There's folks streaming us, I'm sure, all over the country, but the word's getting out about this program because we have great guests like Dr. David Agus, author of a great book, and folks, you should pick it up because it's the future is now. It's called The Lucky Years, How to Thrive in the Brave New World. And Agus is spelled A-G-U-S, by the way, folks. What about folks who are just trying to, you know, take care of their cattle and make sure that, you know, the heat's on and the wood is in the wood stove, and you don't have all the high-tech options.
You don't need them. That's the beauty of these lucky years. So one of the greatest determinants of health is not an hour at the gym or working out, but it's movement over time.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
And so our bodies were designed to move. Your lymphatics that control your immune system have no muscle in their wall. So it's the rhythmic contraction of the muscles in your legs when you walk to actually make your body work.
Mm-hmm.
So movement over time is key. And then the other one, which is just, you know, I think really amazing, is one of the simplest tenets to avoid diabetes is eat your meals the same time every day.
Mm.
Oh, so people who graze, you know, like the cows, have a dramatically higher diabetes rate because our bodies were designed to basically have two or three meals and that's it. And when you have meals all the time, insulin stays up and your body gets resistance, and that's what diabetes is.
Ah, so the snacks laying all over the counters at various workplaces. And
those companies are doing a major disservice. And they think they're helping the employees and being hip and hop and whatever, but they're not. They're doing the opposite.
We actually had Dan Buettner on from the Blue Zones, and you talk about exercise. The centenarians, the way they got to be over 100, they all moved. And they didn't go to the gym. They were in their gardens. They were constantly moving.
Shepherds, So,
and that's the key. I mean, our bodies were designed to move. Yet the richer you are, the more bathrooms in your house, so you don't have to walk room to room to go to the bathroom. The more important you are in a company, the closer your parking space is to your desk. It should be the opposite.
I wonder if we can hang, if you can hang with us for a couple more minutes, and we'd like to take a break and then come back and talk about some practical things. You talk about the book and reversing aging to look, feel, and physically be 10 years younger. Boy, I'd do that if it doesn't cost a whole lot. Maybe we can talk about that and some other items with Dr. David Agus.
I'm happy to stay on. About hanging on, I'm not sure about, but I'll stay on.
Thanks a lot, Dr. David Agus. And again, the book is The Lucky Years, and it's I guess it's we're lucky because, you know, he's compiled and filtered all of the great stuff you read and some of the not so great and giving us the truth. How to Thrive in the Brave New World, The Lucky Years by Dr. David B. Agus, AGUS, MD. We'll be right back here on Healthy You. Skin and heart and, well, all the tissues of the body, I guess keeping them young and being lucky doing it, and maybe not so lucky being purposeful and using technology. That's what we're talking about today with Dr. David Agus, who is author of The Lucky Years, a great book, which really smashes a lot of myths. And boy, you and I were really, I guess, on parallel tracks here. As you were writing the book, and I talk often about how I'm concerned about medical literature and so-called evidence-based medicine, which looks at large groups of people that are like a million individuals, all with their own individual DNA and history and context, and yet we treat them, everyone that walks in the office, as the same person after that. What say you about medical research and what it's told us, Dr. Agus?
You know, big data is a new era that we have now, and it's the notion that President Obama pushed doctors kicking and screaming and crying to go on electronic records, and from it we're starting to learn things. So one of the great studies out of Europe came out, and this is the coolest. They looked at how close you lived to an airport. The closer you lived, the quicker the rate of brain decline as you got older. And so our brain needs quiet. And when you live close to an airport, you don't have that quiet. You know, I have a 150-pound dog that snores. And I don't have the heart to kick her out of the bedroom, so I wear those orange foam earplugs every night, and I get the quiet from my brain so it can restore itself. And we're learning from these big data experiments. We just learned that women with ovarian cancer, for example, happen to be on a blood pressure medicine called a beta blocker, live a year and a half longer. We would have never picked that up from biology, but because now there are tens of thousands of patients in these databases, we can learn. And it's a very powerful way. When you search on Google, your search today is better than it was yesterday. They actually look where people went and improve it. We have to do the same in medicine.
But how does that square when you, I mean, when we talk about individual cancers, it's the age of individualization of cancer therapy where they look at markers on the surface of the individual tumor cells.
But that all goes together.
Yeah.
Is that all of a sudden, instead of just saying, well, everybody with X cancer, we're going to treat this way, we're looking at the data and learning trends. If you're 50 and you're, you know, this weight, maybe your response is going to be different than if you're very skinny. We're starting to learn these individual things. At the same time, you know, we're using technologies, whether it be looking at DNA or protein. So that's the next level. You know, when you stand in front of two Chinese restaurants, the ingredient list is exactly the same. You taste the food. One could be great. One could be bad. Well, DNA is your ingredient list. Protein is what the food tastes like. And so from a drop of blood, you see the proteins, which are the communication molecules. Our body's been talking, and for the first time now, we can actually listen. And it will help us do the right thing in the right patient instead of one size fits all. You know, I did the morning show this morning on CBS about mammograms. The new guidelines came out, age 50, get it every 2 years, et cetera, and it's one size fits all. It makes no sense. Relatively soon, we're going to prick your finger and say, hey, there's some changes in your blood. Why don't you go for a mammogram today?
Mm-hmm. Huh.
It's good to hear you say that. My good friend Barbara Monsees at my alma mater, Wash U, I talk with her about that frequently. But every time these new recommendations that come out, or like you say, the one size fits all, she just cringes. And we talk about that. She's a world, you know, world renowned breast imager. And she says it's not that way. You need to sit down and, as you said earlier, have a conversation. And that includes sometimes your fears and anxieties, too, because that all factors into it.
Get a load of this, is that, you know, colonoscopy is, you know, a test that nobody likes. At age 50, we all have to have it. And you can eliminate colon cancer. The problem is most people don't need it. If you had a colonoscopy and there was no polyp, you didn't need the test. So very soon there will be a blood test this year that says whether you have a polyp or not. So all of a sudden, colonoscopy will only be done in the people who need it. It's very powerful.
Mm-hmm. Tell us about reverse aging to look, feel, and physically be 10 years younger.
This is the wildest thing I've ever seen. And what's amazing is it was buried in the science literature for 60 years. So in the 1950s, this woman, Wanda Ruth Lunsford in New York City, published what turned out to be her only paper in Science. And she was actually kicked out. She took an old rat and a young rat, and she put them to sleep, and she tied their skin together. So after about a day, the blood supplies joined. And then 3 weeks later, she looked in the old rat. The rat's white hairs had turned brown again. There were new neurons growing in the brain. The heartbeat stronger. The muscles were bigger. She claimed she reversed aging. Well, they called her Dracula and Frankenstein and all these crazy names. But earlier this year, three separate laboratories, one at Stanford, one at Harvard, and one at University of California, San Francisco, repeated Wanda's experiment, and it worked. And what they showed is at age 25, and you and I, our stem cells go to sleep. And there are now proteins that can turn them back on and wake them up. So if you're 70 years old and you fell and you broke your leg, very soon we're going to give you these proteins and allow you to heal like a child heals, much quicker. So the cure for many of these diseases is actually asleep within us.
Wow.
And it's a staggering advance that we can now work to turn these stem cells on. And so that's why I'm a believer in prevention. Because I really think that the ability to reverse diseases, not just halt them, is right around the corner. So all we want to do now is have people prevent and delay disease so we can all benefit.
You know, that's funny because next week our guest on the Healthy You radio show is Dr. Michael Rosen. He's the chief wellness officer and the chair of Wellness Institute at the Cleveland Clinic. Mm-hmm. And he is the real age guy. He is the one who did the real research on the real age, which is very much what we're talking about today in terms of what we can do to turn back the clock.
Mm-hmm.
So let's ask this question. If you feel as though you'd like to tap into these things, certainly folks can read your book. If some of the technologies, if they've been given a new diagnosis and you know, they are not hearing what they want from their doctor, what's the next step?
Well, the next step is educate themselves. Mm-hmm. Is that in today's world, you have the ability, whether it be through our book or through many others out there, of learning about things. So you can go in armed with the information. Everything we talk about in the luck years is either available today or will be available shortly. And so, you know, it's the notion that, you know, information is powerful. Healthcare will change from the ground up, not the top down. Mm. So it's not going to be docs who change things. It's going to be patients who push that makes things change.
Tell us about the two-week challenge you have in your book. How are we going to give insight to our doctors?
Well, the key is to know yourself. And so the two-week challenge really is a list of things I want you to pay attention to for 2 weeks so you have all that information so when you sit down with him or her, the time can be useful. Your doctor sees you once a year, every 2 years, and they get a glimpse into you. But going in with the information that you're going to get in that two-week challenge is key. You know, the coolest thing is there's a study, and this is a great study out of Europe, where if you sit cross-legged on the floor, and you could stand up with either one hand or no hands, it puts you in the top 25% of musculoskeletal strength, of muscle strength, and it actually means you're going to live longer.
I think we Dan Buettner gave us that tip when we had him interviewed on the Blue Zones a couple months ago. Yeah.
Oh, good. Dan is great.
Yeah. So we have to ask you a personal question now. Tell us a little bit about your diet, what you eat, and tell us a little bit about, like, for instance, do you work at a standing desk? I mean, how do you employ these things?
So I eat a Mediterranean diet, and you know, the largest study doing comparisons of diet, it won, you know, clear hands down. So it's moderation. I eat my meals the same time every day. I, you know, try to eat a good fat diet, not a low fat diet. And you know, the kids and I and my wife, you know, we go to the farmer's market on Sundays and we kind of plan our meals for the week. I have a treadmill desk at the office, so at a very slow pace, okay, 1 to 2 miles an hour, 2 hours a day when I do emails, I actually can walk. Takes about a week or two to get used to. You know, it's a little tricky at first, but then you do. The other thing I do is I have one of those headsets where when I have these horrible conference calls all day, I can walk around the office. I try to make one of my meetings a day a walking meeting. You know, I helped take care of Steve Jobs, and Steve always told me there are two, you know, reasons to do walking. One is the health benefits. He said the other is if you go for a walk with someone and you're doing a business negotiation and you know whether you're going to turn left or right at the corner and they don't, it gives you a slight advantage.
Oh.
So he thought these things through.
Yeah.
But, you know, I wore one of those devices on my wrist that I was shocked about how little I was moving during the day.
Yeah.
And it really was an eye-opener. I thought, listen, I'm getting up, walking around all day. It turns out I wasn't. And it really was an eye-opener for me. So that's what the power of these devices is, just for you to realize what you're doing. What is your baseline? And then get competitive with yourself. Try to improve it 10%.
It's that accountability. I've had patients tell me that. I beg them, literally sometimes on my knees, I'll do whatever it takes to just take a walk 5 times a week for 20 minutes. I'll take anything. Nothing. Crickets chirping for years. And then they get one of these fitness trackers, and it's like something about that electronic accountability. It was a game changer for them. It's amazing.
It's great. I mean, you know, we get competitive,
and
game theory works. It's kind of cool.
Yeah.
So, Dr. Agus, how do you deal with stress? That's another big spoke on the wheel.
You know, I try to have quiet time every day for myself. So I get home, I go for a walk with the dog, you know, or I sit outside in nature, play with the kids. I try to build in sport, you know, so I do yoga. Listen, I don't like yoga, but it works.
It does.
I got to tell you.
You're right.
I play tennis with the kids. I wanted a sport I could play with the kids and play for decades, so tennis is the one we adopted. I played basketball in college. Very hard to play basketball, you know, as you get older. You get hurt. But so I chose a sport I could do. And then, you know, there's this old Buddhist expression, detach and transcend. And so what I've kind of learned is that you don't want to, you know, fight every battle. You want to take a step back, you know, look down and say, does it really matter if I push in this direction? Is this friend who bugs the hell out of me, is it worth my stress? And then just cut the ties that don't make sense. It's going to affect everything else in your life.
Yeah. I think, you know, we read more and more about social media and addiction and sort of acquired ADD as a population. And it's difficult for people to turn off because we are social animals. And it's a way, it's a very simple way for people to be instantly connected and in many cases validated, even though that validation for nothing. and I think that's another trend that we're going to have to culturally look at, isn't it, among Americans?
Oh, and it takes away from productivity. You know, if you're working and you look up at email or social media, it takes about 3 minutes for your brain to refocus again. And so, you know, choose a time of day. Like I say, listen, this is my email time, you know, from 9 to 11 in the morning. Choose a time of day where you'll answer social media. It's a good thing because you get to connect with people you never would and family members. But don't let it rule you. You rule it.
Yeah, yeah. You have to almost plan it as an appointment in your schedule. I mean, it has to be limited, and I need some help sometimes with that kind of thing being managed by those around me.
And it goes back to moderation. How much do we talk about moderation and food and all of the other things in our life?
Listen, Grandma was right. You know, she always said, "David, moderation." She was right.
Where do you stand on alcohol? I mean, because some people find that, I mean, the radicals among sort of the alcohol abuse crowd would say, well, if you de-stress with a martini five nights a week, you are an alcoholic. Well, I'm not so certain about that. Are you?
No. I mean, the data on alcohol are clear. You know, moderate alcohol, you know, 1 to 2 drinks a night actually has a health benefit. I'm a believer, you want to take 2 nights a week off.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And then the second thing is, you know, alcohol is a depressant. So you take alcohol, you fall asleep because you get tired. Then 2-3 hours later, you get a rebound surge in adrenaline and you wake up. So you don't want enough alcohol that it affects your sleep.
Right.
So I know that if I have up to a glass and 3/4 of wine, I'm great and mm-hmm. I can sleep. Yeah. A little bit more than that, you know, it affects my sleep. And I try as much as I can not to do more than that. Sometimes you don't win. But it's moderation.
You don't win.
An enjoyable thing. And it's a cue to your body, hey, let's leave the rest of the day behind and move forward.
Well, Dr. Eggers, you have been an amazing guest.
You bet.
Dr. Eggers has just published the book, or has just written the book, The Lucky Years, How to Thrive in a Brave New World of Health. Dr. Eggers, I'll be honest, I didn't realize all of this was out there as far as what's going to be at our fingertips in the future, and you're giving us insight, and it's just been a fountain of knowledge. Thank you so much.
And we can stay in touch with you, of course, on the CBS Morning News, but what else? Do you have a website that people can look at?
DavidAegus.com, A-G-U-S, and on, you know, the social media that you hate, the Twitter and the Facebook.
Oh, I don't hate them. I use them myself. Do you have a Twitter? What's your Twitter handle?
David Agus, A-G-U-S.
Right. Hey, great. Hey, thanks a lot, David. Appreciate it.
Thank you guys so much. I'll talk to you soon.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Wow, what a tour de force, huh? Man, interesting stuff, and clearly a high-energy guy, so he's a productive dude. And this is a really interesting book because it really is a blend of the technology that is, I mean, 2 years ago we would have been talking about blood tests to diagnose cancer, to give you your risk assessment of this or that, and now it's here. I mean, it's just amazing.
I just love the fact he saw a need. You know, he knew that patients weren't getting better all the time with drugs, and he went another step, another dimension, and it's really helping a lot of people.
You're listening to Healthy You on KMEM 100.5. Questions, comments? We'll be back and take some open lines calls, 465-7225.
And 1-800-748-7875.
It's a new year. It's a new you. Learn about it on Healthy You every Tuesday at 10 o'clock, KMEM 100.5. Be right back. We're back at 7 till the hour. Now, you may be thinking to yourself after that, let's see, Mediterranean diet, treadmill desk, meditate, transcend, get quiet space. That's the Southern California, high-powered New York City, you know, CBS Morning News version of that. It's okay. Not impossible.
No, and I think you could take maybe just a baby step of that. Maybe just one. I don't see anything wrong with standing meetings. I think that's that's pretty much accepted. Why not start standing meetings? And then if you have a meeting between two people, why can't you have a walking meeting?
Right.
Why do you have to sit down and eat lunch or whatever?
Do you know why?
Why do you have to do that?
Because we live in the Midwest where tradition and cultural change is often difficult to do. And so if someone in the group or in the office says, hey, let's do a walking meeting, people are like, well, I sort of like what I'm doing. It's different. You know. So it takes risk for someone to step out there and step on the ice, as it were, and take a little risk to lead those kind of things. Maybe you, dear listener, can be a leader among your network. Maybe it's your family. Maybe your husband who comes home and says, I want to sit down and eat meat and potatoes and French fries and fried chicken and biscuits and gravy, that's okay in its time, in its place. But you know that he's got prediabetes and his cholesterol's off the roof. And he's a little short of breath now doing chores. Maybe that's the time you say, hey, before we do that, let's go for a little walk.
Yeah.
Let's just go for a walk with the dogs.
And with the kids.
And let's not have any. This is a problem I have. Everything always has to have a goal and a purpose. And just for the sake of getting out and walking, that alone can probably satisfy some of that separation, transcending, getting stuff cleared
quiet
from
time,
your mind.
As quiet time, as he mentioned, for those of you in the country, you know, you're going to have
I actually do get things done while I walk. I think of speeches. Mm-hmm. So it's not a matter of you not doing anything. You can do a lot when you walk.
Did you think of the wonderful blog you wrote when you were walking this weekend? Because you wrote a wonderful blog. I have to brag on you. I mean, they're all good, but some are better than others. This was one of those better than others. And already you've had a lot of looks on the drtobler.com website. It's called every year I thought about it as I read it, and sometimes I get a preview of it and I get to help a little bit with the editing. It's a lot of fun. And I thought about all of the lists that come out at the end of the year, the turn of the year. You always hear some
the
university
trends.
Comes out. No, the words and the phrases you're not supposed to use, like at the end of the day, kick the can down the road. So starting out sentences with the word so. I mean, I remember the list this year that came out with. So we go. So you wrote one. The new four-letter word for you this year is?
Diet.
The new four-letter word is diet. Why is that? I mean, everyone thinks, well, wait, we just said Mediterranean
okay,
diet.
No. We? First of all, diet means what you, if you want to go strictly to scientifically, it is what do you eat during the week? That's all it is. Mm-hmm. But what I'm saying and what the new trend is, the millennials are way in front of us. There's this gal called Lena Dunham.
Mm-hmm. She's quite a controversial character,
right.
But yeah.
But this Instagram thing is a big deal, and all these young kids are catching on. And she basically said, it's about the brain, not the, and I'm going to, it's the word for donkey, okay?
Right.
So she's the one that took off on that and said that.
When you're talking about eating and nutrition.
And then Weight Watchers came out and said, Weight Watchers didn't do this on their own. Weight Watchers came out and said, okay, well, no longer can you get all these points that you can buy, you can eat potato chips and get on the treadmill. Mm-hmm. You have to actually eat quality meals. So it was like, oh my gosh, this is happening. The word diet, and it, to me, I'm going to take it another step. It's not having to be a certain weight or having to be a certain pant size. These kids are actually embracing the fact, okay, it's about health. It's about strongness. It's about how, and not just kids, the older folks are catching on too. How do you deal with stress? Are we exercising? All that in a package called practical wellness. That's what it's all about. It's not all about your weight and your how you look, but you're not going to feel. I'm not going the route that you can eat all you want and do what all you want. I'm going the route of you got to do what the right foods, eat real foods. You've got to exercise. You got to move every day. That's how we learned that from Dan Buettner in the Blue Zones. You have to deal with stress in a healthful way. And you have to sleep the right amount.
And the payoff is that whereas diets usually fail because you don't see the results either quickly enough. I mean, I don't mean the first week because we lose a lot of water weight when we go on a diet, right? Every fad diet. But I'm talking about sustained, rewarding weight loss is I mean, if you look at the studies, less than 5% of people achieve that on a, quote, diet. Sort of that begrudging, I got to give this up and give that up. So you don't get those sustained results, right? But if you change what the word diet means to meaning weight loss, so that you have a realistic goal, you'll find that the payoff comes in the way you feel. I mean, if you just change a few little things, even though we were talking about technology for the last half an hour with Dr. Eggers, what did he ultimately say he did every day? Oh, walk the dog.
Walk the dog. Right.
The kids,
simple stuff.
Walk around the office when he's having a phone meeting, really. And eats a Mediterranean
diet.
You could do a lot worse than a Mediterranean diet. Mm-hmm. And yet, you can tell how sharp that guy is. Mm-hmm. I mean, he is firing on not 8, but 12 or 16 cylinders.
He does not have sugar carb brain.
No.
That's right. And so I think that listening to yourself, I mean, that was another theme that we keep hearing over and over. You know when you're feeling good. We know when you're not feeling well. Forget about what you look like in the mirror. You know it.
And also taking not blaming it on other people. Taking responsibility for your own health is huge. Just like we learned last week on the sobriety solution.
Right. That's right. Well, for Dr. Helene, for producer Elisa Kiger, I'm Dr. Randy Tobler. Hope you enjoyed today's edition of Healthy You. And next week we'll be talking about the do-over. This is your do-over, the 7 secrets to losing weight, living longer, and getting a second chance at the life you want. So it's a great time of year to be thinking about those things. Hey, even if you only incorporate 10% of what you hear, you're 10% down that path.
Oh, the baby steps. Yes.
There you go. And check out Helene's blog on drtobler.com. Remember this week, be well, share it with someone you love, take a walk, try a little yoga with someone you love. Even though it looks silly, it'll feel good.
It feels great. I did it this morning.
We'll see you next time on Healthy You.